those of you who got an invite, welcome to Nerd Prom.
No matter where in the world you are, we're all Nerds International. With the hyphen.
Hello, everyone. Hi. I'm back.
Hello.
I'm back now. See, he says broadcasting. Total silence. Shh. How does it say on broadcast? Where does it say I'm broadcasting to?
You said you were broadcasting.
Oh, I thought it showed up somewhere.
Oh.
I see. Okay. So I'm just getting my screen here all organized. Yeah, okay. So, you got your three characters. we have Petrus, the curious noble, Maeve, the talented archer, at times, given my experiences, and we have Amelia, blade for hire.
And my specification with that would be pronounced Amala.
Amala? Very well, then. Amala it shall be.
And I'm Petrus.
When I first started reading it, I always used to say Petri. And I'm like, yeah, this is the Petri dish, curious noble.
You say Petri, I hear Petri, I go, Petri fly, oh, Petri fall.
I'm going to bring up the map there now. Images. Hyboria map. Okay. Everyone should be able to see the map.
Yep.
Down in the bottom right-hand corner, you will see a yellow circle. And this is where this adventure is starting off. It's in the desert lands of Iranistan. And Iranistan is a windswept, desolate desert. And it's always windy, and there's shifting sands and sand dunes. But there's a lot of cities down here. There's a lot of great, great big cities. And I shouldn't say a lot, but there is a thriving community down here. In this part of the world, the thing is, the lands in between the cities, these great walled cities, is pretty hardcore. People will attack and kill people who are living near seemingly worthless piece of land only because it's next to a small river or a small spring. The one thing about Iranistan is that the sands are constantly shifting, and for probably every city that's above ground, there's probably two cities that have been buried up by the sands of time that one day, depending on the winds, you can see a great spire. And then the next day, the winds have shifted again, and that spire is now hidden underneath sand dunes. So there's a lot of ruins that lead back to the ancient times. As for your particular group, you guys are currently... we're currently working for a caravan. It's a decent way to make some money. It can be hard work, obviously. There's long hours. You're there as being hired on to help protect and help with the loads and the lifting. But you're going through these lands. It's dangerous. It's a dangerous spot. And Iranistan is a relatively, it can be considered beautiful when it's not windy or stormy, but there's mountainous areas and there's rough terrain, but yet the sand is constantly shifting around you. And on most times, there's always dust clouds nearby or you're going through. But in this particular travel from one city to the next, and the city doesn't really matter. For you guys, you've just been going, you go here, and then you go to the next city, and the next city. So it's never really been anything that important. You're just hoping to get some money, to get some, you know, to go exploring further. You know, you're trying to try out new things. You're just trying to make a living. And I'm going to start you guys off. You guys are all walking, or sorry, you're in a on a cart, being hauled by a camel. And in the last, say, 6 to 8 hours, there's been a very strong windstorm and sandstorm, and the wind's been whipping against everyone, and it's getting into your clothes, it's getting into your eyes. You know, you can barely see, you know, 5 feet in front of you. Like, even though you know that your own camel that's hauling the cart in front of you is, you can barely see it at times. And during this particular caravan, you know, there was probably another 10 to 15 other carts, same as yours. Your particular cart was tasked with carrying salt, big salt blocks. So the wind has been howling, and you realize that the visibility is getting really, really hard to see. And even the camel is now having difficulty, and you guys are having trouble trying to control the camel because it's starting to not want to be around. Who would like to be the driver of this particular cart and camel?
I can give it a try.
So, Amala. Let's see. Oh, I got to write your stat down. Seeing I don't have it there. Your animal handling is 8, and you have no ranks in it. So, just so you know, I got that fixed for you now. 8 and 0. Okay, so this is going to be a difficulty 2 roll.
Like that?
Like that. Now, unfortunately, because you don't have any training in it, you don't have any focus in it. So you only got 1 success. So, you know, this camel is really starting to act up, and it kind of gets a start. And I'm going to have the other two players to make agility rolls as you... let me see, what particular skill is that? Let's have a look. Yeah, make an agility roll. The other two make agility rolls. And it's a difficulty 1.
Okay, so I want to get under 10?
You want to get under 10, yep. Oh, sorry. No, I did it wrong. My apologies. It's not agility that you need to roll. It's going to be where's it to?
Acrobatic.
Yeah, it's going to be acrobatics. My apologies. That's just your stats.
Ah. I was like,
Yep.
Oh, lovely.
Somebody rolled a 20.
And yours is not working. So, oh, this, you know why? Because this is... Okay, I'm going to fix yours.
Yeah, I'm not sure how
he's got to fix the string.
Yeah. 2d20. That's that one. please.
Too much hot tubbing.
He should have been sitting there with his laptop in the hot tub fixing these strings.
I should have been. I apologize. I apologize. So much.
That might not be a great idea.
All right, there we go. So you can feel free to roll that again, though.
No? Oh, me? Okay.
Yeah. Why is yours doing that? I just rolled yours, didn't
I? It doesn't like me.
Alright, let's see what's going on here.
You want me to close the character sheet?
Sam must have got into it here. Yeah, just close the character sheet, and as acrobatics, you're rolling.
Yep.
Ah, I see what I had done wrong. Try it now. Same thing. Hold on. Now it'll work. I guarantee it. There we go.
Wow, those are both under 12.
They are both under 12. Success. Okay, so on your character sheets now, whenever I ask you guys to make a roll, if you pass, and I say that you ever need it, one success, and you actually roll two, you get to collect momentum. So on your character sheet, Emily, there is a button there called momentum, right underneath the attacks bar. And you can just type in one. You just, you know, add to it, that's all. You can mouse wheel up and down or whatever. If you ever want to spend momentum, you can double click on it, and it'll actually subtract it and put it over on the side.
And those are like bennies.
Yeah, they're like bennies. So you get one momentum. Dan, you passed. You got a success as well, but you also got a 20. So where is it to? Yes, you got a pass. But you don't get a momentum. But you give me doom. I'm going to take doom instead because you got that 120. So as the camel starts and the cart kind of jerks back, two of you guys are kind of bounced around. And, you know, the camel is kind of like finally had enough. It wants to leave. And, you know, it's getting kind of out of control. And you guys nearly fall off the back of the wagon. You know, you nearly fell off the wagon. And meanwhile, Maeve is up in front, and she's trying to, you know, struggle, trying to control which way the camel is going, and it's not going so well for her right now.
Can I try to calm the camel in some way?
Are you a camel singer?
Oh, I'm a camel whisperer.
No, they have a thing. That's actually a thing. A camel singer.
Well, you don't have the camel singer talent? Come on, everyone takes that. It's like boating.
Yeah, if you're gonna be traveling deserts and you don't have the camel singer talent, you just wasted your time.
You can certainly try. You're kind of in the back of the cart right now, so and the camel's kind of hauling around and bouncing and pulling and kind of running. Yeah, go. You can. I'm gonna get. I'm gonna spend the doom. So I'm gonna spend the doom. And I'm going to say that. As you're kind of losing control, the cart of the that you guys are on kind of goes over the tip of a sand dune and actually starts to roll downwards or slide downwards now. And the camel is obviously very panicked and is getting kind of treacherous now on top of the cart. So, Petrus, if you want to try to get control, you'll have to try to get up to where Maeve is riding. So I'm going to say it's a difficulty 2 for you to get there.
Up to where Amala is riding?
Yes. Sorry, up to where Amala is riding. Yes.
I was going to say I'm not riding while I'm riding in the car, but...
I was playing Maeve last time. It'll take him a minute here.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It was scarred into my brain.
Scarred? What a lovely way to put that.
Seared. So I think... Dan, you still there, buddy? I think Dan's muted again. Dan, are you muted?
No.
Okay.
No, I'm not.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yep. So it's a D2. Because of the, it's now going down over the side of the sand dune, it's going to be a D2 maneuver for you to try to get up there. But it is risky. Just
wait,
so you know.
Wait, what skill am I rolling?
You're going to roll your acrobatics. What's Maeve's doing? What Maeve's is doing that now? Oh, sorry. Two successes. So yeah, you're able to get up there, and you get yourself a Benny, or sorry, a momentum, so you can give yourself a momentum.
Yay! I like them.
Oh wait, no, no, I'm sorry. I have to take that back from you because I said D2, so you got two successes. So, yeah, so you got you managed to get up. You know, as the camel is now starting to struggle, and the cart starting to go down over the sand dune, and the wind is whipping. You finally get up to where Maeve is, or sorry, where Amala is sitting.
May I try to calm the camel?
It's up to her. It's up to her if she's going to give you the reins or not.
Dude, it's like, you know, if he's good, I'm not going to let go of the reins.
I'm not looking to drive the camel. I'm trying to maybe dismount or do something to actually calm the camel itself.
Do we have any apples or carrots?
Yeah.
See, the thing is well.
Now let me describe the scene again. Now, you guys are now going down over the top of it, sliding down over the top of a sand dune. It's pretty bouncy. The camel, you know, Maeve.
Oh, okay.
Or sorry, Amala lost control. So now, if you wanted to. This is a good opportunity for you to take a fortune, and you can spend the fortune point to say that the camel, you know, it gets brought up and like and it gets stuck. You know what I mean? And then you can get out and try as it's fighting. Like, because a fortune point can be used to alter the storyline somewhat.
Yep.
Well, I'll spend the fortune point then. So how do I spend the fortune point?
Now, but here's the thing. If you spend the fortune, yeah, it's all you got to do is double click. Is you're the one who needs to...
Oh, get out and do something. Okay. Yeah.
So I'll give you that fortune back.
Maeve will attempt to sing to the camel. Don't ask me to sing, though, because I'm not that great a singer.
So if you do it, you got to describe how you're doing it. You got to make it sound like a story.
Okay, well, Maeve will climb up closer to Amala, slowly, of course, because she doesn't want to fall out of the cart. And she will attempt to croon to the camel to try and calm it down. And she sings a story that her mother sang to her when she was very young to try and put her to sleep. Yeah.
All right. So make a animal handling roll. And because of the way you describe it, I'm going to just say it's a D1.
Okay. I don't think she... Well, what's her skill?
Her skill. Well, you
nine,
passed.
So nine. So she had one success.
One success. Actually, you got two successes because your focus number, your second number there, where it says 9 and 2, because you rolled a 2 or less, you actually get a bonus success. So you got two successes.
Oh wow! So you can sing the camels.
So you can give yourself another momentum.
Sweet.
And you can use these to upgrade stuff or whatever, right? So, you know, you get up, and finally the camel starts to calm down, and, you know, as you're up trying to calm down the camel, you know, your feet are sinking into the sand, and the wind is whipping. You know, it's getting kind of hard for all of you out there right now. I am going to spend 2 doom to make everyone make a discipline check. And the discipline check is going to be a D1. And what this is because the fear and the trepidation of being trapped in a sandstorm now, you're on the side of a sand dune, you can't see anything, is really starting to play on your mind. And for those who fail, we'll take a D2 damage roll to your resolve.
So it looks like I got 1 success. Oh, I got leg.
So everyone got a pass except for Petrus. So I'm going to roll 2d6. And essentially a steely glare is what it's going to be. So I'll just roll this one right here. 2d6. And you take 1 point of resolve damage. So if you have any courage, courage would reduce it. That's the same as that's the equivalent of armor.
I'm too young to have any courage.
All right, so then you only take 1 point of resolve, but because it's a 5, it will give you you're now kind of stunned. All right, you're kind of frozen in concern and terror as you're kind of standing there in the wind, right? And you guys, Maeve and Amala, can both see the concern that's in Petrus' eyes.
Have we brought the cart to a stop?
Yes, the cart is brought to a stop.
Then I'm going to do the best I can to lead the camel around into the shelter of the cart. I mean, it's not going to be completely sheltered, but...
Oh, yeah, that's a good idea.
I don't think that traveling further with the camels is, like, try to shelter the cart. Maybe they would probably have some kind of furs or something, tarps, canvas, something similar that they drop over the side to create a windbreak on one side. So underneath the cart would be sheltered from the wind and the sand.
Yep. So. That's no problem. So you can roll your... As you're doing that, I'm going to assume that you're kind of setting up like a little miniature shelter for the animal and kind of, you know, protect the animal. So I'm going to say that that's more of a survival skill. So it's a D1 just to set it up.
Ah!
So you're having some serious trouble. The camel is fighting against you as you're trying to get it in. The wind's still coming in. What's everyone else doing at this point?
I will attempt to sing to the camel some more in order to calm it down so it won't fight so much.
You know, okay. These things are biting, they spit.
What about you, Dan?
Well, I'm freaking out because things are getting bad and I'm young.
You don't see me trying to throw canvas around here?
And I'm going to... I guess I'm going to go try to help with the camel.
Okay. I'm going to get you to roll a discipline check to see if you can snap yourself out of the stun that you're in.
No, I'm too freaked out.
And I'll take the doom. Thanks, Dan. So, you know, everyone's kind of struggling with the camel now. Petrus is kind of like just standing there and the wind's whipping them in the face, and he's obviously has that sense of dread. And, you know, you can see he's kind of like, oh no, like this is not cool. Amala, I'm going to get you to roll another animal handling roll. D1.
You mean Maeve?
Sorry, yes. Damn it. Yes, absolutely.
I just guessed.
Yeah. So it's a D1. So everyone's still kind of struggling. So suddenly, as everyone's fighting with the camel, I'm going to spend 2 doom. And the camel suddenly rears up against Amala. And, you know, you lose grip of the reins, and it seems to bolt. If you would like, you can try to grab it by doing an acrobatics skill. It will be a D3 if to get a hold of the reins.
But I can't add dice without momentum, correct?
You can always spend doom. You can tell me that you're going to add some doom. And to do that, you just double-click on your doom the doom number there, and it'll let me know how many you're going to add. Okay.
How do I do a second one?
Just double-click it again. All right, so that's two.
Now,
so
will that automatically add it to my acrobatics roll?
No, what you got to do now, you put your modifier down in the bottom. So you spent two, so you put two down in the modifier square.
Yeah, I remember now.
Yeah, and now you can roll it. Four successes. Holy crap.
I didn't even need to spend the damn deal. Oh, no, I did because I needed three successes. So I only got one extra.
You got one extra, so that's a momentum. And just as the last second, you know, as the camel's about to break into lose sight of the camel, you manage to get your hand around the leash and haul it back and keep control of it just a little bit more. Okay. Let's see. What's everyone would like to do now? You're still trying to set up your camp, right? Your shelter.
Yeah, I'm just taking advantage of the fact that the wagon itself, cart itself, provides a roof-type cover. We just need to get furs or something draped on the wind side to block the wind blowing it.
I'll help with that, and I assume the camel's tied up now.
Yep. So if you want to make a helping roll, what I get you to do is you need to roll, this is going to be based on survival, so you just got to roll 1d20 for your survival. So all you got to do is go into your modifier, put -1, and roll your survival. We got to go with the, So you got one success. So now Amala makes her regular roll, as usual.
Survival, right?
Survival. And you managed to get yourself one success, and was originally going to be a D2. So you got it because of the success from Maeve. So you managed to get yourself up a decent shelter, and you know you managed to get a little bit of break from the breaking winds. But Petrus is still kind of standing out in the winds. Dan, Petrus, I'm gonna get you to make another discipline roll to see if you can break the. You did. All right. So you're starting to come to, and you're realizing now that you're not doing so well.
And the women got everything under control. Come over here, Sonia. Get in here and out of the wind. You'll feel better.
Yeah, we made a nice campsite, and I assume we got something in a pot going. Some soup or something.
I got sand in my mouth. It's gritty. I don't like it.
We should tell this camel to be careful because it might be in the pot some night.
So as Petrus comes over and you guys are in the howling sand, you know, although the whistling sound is just now ferocious, you guys feel somewhat inured to the effects of the winding and the howling. It's no more as terrifying. You feel like you may kind of last through this a little bit more. I'm going to make everyone make a observation roll, and it's a D1 for everyone. Okay, so Petrus succeeded. Amala didn't succeed, but you did succeed in giving me doom. Thank you. I will take that.
I was totally exhausted from wrestling that camel and then setting up a camp. I nearly had to go smack that kid because he was just useless.
And
that would have brought him up.
And Maeve succeeded. So, you know, Amala, as she's still trying to set up the camp and getting it all straightened away, you did. You took a mouthful of sand. It's very uncomfortable. You know, your eyes are now stinging and burning as you're trying to get everything set together. You know, there's a little small crack in the in the tarp, and the wind was kind of howling through. But both Petrus and Maeve are able to see through the howling sands now something that you never noticed much earlier, and that is what appears to be some sort of structure breaking through the wind, something that you didn't notice earlier. It seems to be like an old building or a wall of a building, and you know, it's kind of in and out of your sight of vision. But it seems to be relatively close by, probably within, you know, like 10 to 20 meters.
Interesting.
That is interesting.
Do we see any signs that anyone is there or has been there? I guess we would have to go investigate.
In this wind, in these shifting sands, if there's ever been any tracks there, they're gone. If there were tracks there 15 minutes ago, they're gone.
Well, not even tracks, but like camping stuff.
It's too hard to tell from there right now. There's no way you could do it from where you're standing.
Okay, but we for sure don't see a fire there.
No, definitely don't see a fire.
Well, maybe later on in the morning we can check it out or something. In the meantime, I'm going to have some of this stew.
So you're trying to get some food ready?
Yep, I put something in a pot. It's mystery meat. We're not really sure what it is. Something we kill along on the way, I would assume.
Maybe gecko.
I would, well, you know. I wouldn't eat a gecko, sorry. I had one as a pet. I wouldn't think they would taste like chicken.
So as the wind is howling and the image of the of this structure not that far away from you is you know, in and out of the sand, you guys continue to stand there huddling in this small little bit of lee of the wind and the sand, and just trying to, you know, stay somewhat okay. Go ahead.
Do you think we could possibly lead the camel over into the shelter of that building, the structure?
Maybe. I'm not sure. It's really windy. I think we'd be better off just leaving it here.
Well, I'm not going to tell you. It's up to you guys.
Well, I don't see it as clearly as you guys because I still got sand in my eyes. If it's too far.
Yeah, I don't want to leave this shelter. This sandstorm's freaking me out, man.
Let's just wait till the sandstorm blows by, and then we
then I'm going to roll up in my cloak underneath the wagon and just wait her out.
All right.
And by making mystery meat stew. I don't know if you want to roll for mystery meat stew.
Okay. So after So you guys are all huddling up as long as you can, right?
Yep, underneath the wagon with as many windbreaks up as we can. And after a while, the sand will be piling up against the windbreak, so it should get even more sheltered.
Yep, and you're absolutely right. After, say, within, you know, you guys are huddled in and you're trying to, you know, make the best of a bad situation. As the winds are blowing through, suddenly the doom counter goes down. 1, 2, 3, 4. So as you're there eating, suddenly you feel like the ground underneath you is starting to move and to shift. And sand now starts to slowly but then rapidly starts to kind of fill in underneath where you guys, your tarp is, and it feels like everything's starting to shift. And suddenly whole sand dune face itself starts to slide. I'm going to get everyone to make an acrobatic roll or suffer damage. D1, yep.
Oh, good, I got success.
So anyone who got more than one success gets an extra momentum.
Yay.
You're just collecting momentum, Maeve.
I guess.
And as you guys manage to back off a tiny bit, you manage to get on away from the now collapsing sand dune that you guys have been kind of camped on underneath. And you hear the yell and the scream of the camel as it gets caught up and it gets swept underneath and away out of your sight as the wind is still howling and it goes silent. And as fast as it happened, it was over. And now the cart seems to be missing. You can't see the camel, and you guys are all kind of standing there, buried up to your shoulders and covered in sand and even more whipping, you know, even more distraught. I'm going to make everyone make a discipline roll. D2, please. Okay, so nobody passed. So everyone take 2d6 damage. Now I'll let you guys roll that for yourself. A 5 or a 6 will mean that you're stunned. And there's also 1 point of damage. So anyone who has courage can subtract. Okay, Petrus, you take 2 points of resolve damage because you rolled a 2. Amala takes 1 point of damage and is stunned. And Maeve, you take 1 point of resolve damage and you are stunned.
Okay, where do I put the damage and the stun?
Okay, up in the on your character sheet, where it says resolve, that's your mental damage.
Okay, so how much do I subtract from that?
You just subtract 1 from it.
Okay, so now we have a cart we have to pull by ourselves, or find another camel. Great.
What about the salt?
Everything was obviously swept up.
It's been swept away, and it's just like an avalanche in the mountains, only this was an avalanche of sand, and I'm going to look around to see, can we still see the structure?
I hope we had insurance.
I don't think even Geico would cover that.
If we can still see the structure, I'm going to grab the timid kid by the arm, even though I'm stunned, and start dragging him off towards the structure.
I'm pretty sure the insurance covers acts of crime.
Funny. So,
all right.
So, yeah, I'm going to make everyone make another observation roll to see if they can refine their D1, refine their tower.
Wow.
Poor Petrus. Petrus. Maeve, you get another momentum.
Crying over the lost salt.
Woohoo.
What did we need to roll? I'm sorry, my grandson.
Oh, no, no problem. It's your observation, D1.
The dice are with me in this game.
So you rolled a 20. So you do see it. But just as you see it into the distance, suddenly the ground underneath your particular feet, Amala, starts to give away, and you feel like you yourself are getting caught up into the shifting sands, as if like you're now the ground is soaking you into the sand dune itself, and you're starting to get pulled in. I'm going to make you roll 1d6, and this is going to be for regular damage. And you do not take any damage, and you are not considered grappled by the sand. You're not being held in there. So you manage to pull yourself free.
And I'm dragging the kid by the arm, and I'm going to lunge further when I feel it sucking away at my feet. You know, like.
And now, of course, you can obviously see the structure that's off in the, not that far, probably, but, you know, 15 meters, by the way it looks right now.
If we get in the lee side of the structure, so we get out of the wind, at least catch our breath.
So is everyone going to try to make their way to the structure?
Yep.
All right. Within a very few short minutes, you guys are all managed. Are now fighting against the wind. Any trace of your little camp that you had set up and your stew and the camel, you can't see. It's gone. You have no idea what happened to it.
And that was good mystery meat stew, darn it.
It was good mystery meat stew. It was.
And we had salt for it.
You did. You know, but you all now managed to get to the what looks appear to be an old adobe-style wall, and there is an open porthole slash door, arch-shaped. And inside of it, you can see nothing but darkness and it's black, but you can actually see on the floor cobblestones. So there's not that much sand on the inside, and it seems relatively sheltered. Are you all guys going to go in?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, we should probably get a light lit so we don't get eaten by a group.
First of all, I'm not so sure we got a light. First, I want to get out of the wind.
Oh, yeah, but then we got a light stuff.
So you guys all go inside, and inside you can see, again, ancient stone structure, and it's a large, fairly large room, roughly, say, 30 by 40 feet, maybe 40 feet square, roughly. And on the side of the walls, you can see various scones for torches, and there are several torches that are still in there. There is sand drifting in through the doorway and in several areas, but it's dark. But you can faintly make out on the far side of the room that you're in, it seems to be even darker, like it is a darker shape there. But it is fairly dark there right now. So anyway, your guys are inside here. There is, as you walked in and by the scones holding the torches, you can see embossed sculptures into the wall itself. And it seems to be it looks Egyptian in nature. The faces of one of the statues has like a pointed beard. Their arms are crossed. They have a large plumed hat over their head in the shape of the statue. But the bottom half of what looks to be a person seems to be serpentine in nature.
Okay, if there's a stargate here, I'm not going through.
Well, as we look around where we found these walls, is there like anything opening into an interior room where we can get more shelter?
Well, it's quite possible that the darkness shape on the far side of the room could be a hallway, or it could go deeper into whatever structure that you're in right now.
Well, then I would go investigate that to see if we can get further out of the wind to where we can get sheltered and, like, may have
okay.
said maybe.
Perhaps we should light one of these torches just so we don't trip over stuff. And
yeah, no problem.
I assume we have flint and steel at least.
Yes, that's right. You know, you have your basic supplies there. You got your rations and stuff. So, yeah. I'm going to be somewhat of a jerk about this, and I'm going to ask everyone to, whoever's going to want to light a torch, just to make a survival roll to see if they can get, using their flint and steel, to get these torches lit.
Three.
So you got yours lit. We have Amala is right in hers. And Dan still, and Petrus is still, you know, coughing up sand, and he's still got, you know, he's having a rough go in the last
what,
is
he a city
bit.
Boy or something?
I'm a noble.
He needs some of the light.
Everything.
I'm going to pound him on the back. Cough it up, kid.
Well,
he's a little rich kid.
I want to search my lore. I'm puzzled. I'm not really concentrating on the task. I'm trying to figure out if I've ever heard of the imaginary land of Egypt.
And you probably. I'm going to look at Maeve. Do you think he's ever had to actually light his own torch before?
Probably not.
And I'm rolling my eyes.
I'm a curious actually, noble. I've never done anything for myself.
Haven't you read a book? Parent. You have at least read a book, though, I would assume.
Oh, that's all I've done. It's read books.
We've got our torches lit. Just stay behind us.
Yes, the women will protect you.
Oh, Petrus. obviously now with the two other torches lit quite handily by the skilled adventurers, Petrus, if you would like, you can also have your torch lit by using the lit torches off the wall from the two others. But as the light now shines from the torches, it lights up the structure that you're in. And above you, you can see somewhat of a slightly domed ceiling. And in the dome ceiling, the torches flickering and there's shadows, you can see more embossed shapes. And again, you see more serpentine-looking structures. And they, from the outside of the, from the top of the wall to the center of the ceiling, the snakes, that's the orientation that these serpentine structures, or these serpentine embossed etches? I don't know, how do I say that? It's embossed, I'm going to say embossed sculptures, just to say it.
It's easier. I'm thinking you must mean a bas relief.
A bas relief, yes, thank you. That's exactly it, thank you. And in the center of the ceiling, you see what appears to be a symbol that looks like an intertwined serpent, and it has two heads facing each other.
Snakes. Well, I didn't have to be snakes. All right.
Well, they're not moving. They're just like sculptures.
Can I use my lore to see if I've ever heard of such a thing before? Or...
Absolutely. D1. These... Oh, so you get yourself another momentum.
Woohoo!
Well, I've actually got ranks in lore.
So, Maeve, as you're looking at it, you realize that these are the symbols of Set. It's a very ancient religion that actually hails from the country of Stygia. And it's kind of, you know, it's a religion that's, you know, was spread all wider, you know, it's not uncommon to see these symbols. But this particular symbol to you looks very ancient, like it's a very old style of symbol, which to you makes you realize that, you know, this is not relatively new. This is a very ancient structure that you're in.
Okay, I will tell them that. Does this look like a temple? Like it might have been used for religious worship or something?
It does. It does look like it could have been used for religious purposes at some point. And as your torches are obviously lit, on the far side of the wall, you actually do see another exit that heads out. But this particular exit is smaller in height, probably half the size of what a person would need to be. So if you ever want to walk through this particular opening, it's you got to scooch over and kind of scooch in and, you know, walk in bent over.
Are there dwarves or halflings in this world?
There is not. Nope.
Great.
I've got all kinds of creepy feelings when you told me about the size of this.
Me too.
Do you see any like slither marks around it?
You do not, other than the windswept sands that's actually been sweeping in through the door. that's all you can see right now.
Lovely. I wouldn't go too far into this place.
There might be
still some pets around.
And like, is there like anything like that we could like push over that entry so things aren't? Because I kind of want to get a nap here, but
I wouldn't take a nap without sending up a watch order.
Well, first of all, I want to see if there's something around here that we can kind of cover or close up that entrance. It's not that big if it's half the size of a person.
As you look around the open room that you're currently in, you see no signs of furniture or any type of item that could suitably use to block off this particular entranceway or exitway.
Hey, Petrus.
What about in the outer entryway that we came through? This was, you know, are there like fallen masonry or rocks out there that... I'm perfectly willing to be hauling rocks up and filling up that so I can get a sleep without, like, ew.
If you wanted to go back out and look around for some of that stuff, you can certainly feel free.
I'm going to go look for, see if I can find enough rocks where we can fill that entry thing with rubble.
You might want to get... well, I was going to say Petrus to help you.
Petrus, have you ever had to lift a rock up in your whole life?
Don't get your hands blistered.
Look at these noble hands.
Wait.
Manicured hands.
You're a big, strong man. You can help carry rocks.
Yeah, but I've heard about this thing that nobles do instead of doing real work, that they do these things like in these, they call them gymnasiums, where they go in there and they do a lot of running around and jumping and pretend work and call it exercise.
Oh, that's a new one on me, I guess.
Yeah,
why would you want to pretend work? I don't understand that concept.
Because I have a command. Because my command bonus is really high, I usually don't have to work.
Well, you could always try it on the two of us.
What if we throw a torch in and see what we can see in that small space?
Oh, well, that's, you go ahead.
I'm actually not a bad idea. I just hope nothing slithers out of it.
All right, so who's going to throw the torch?
I'll throw my torch.
Okay.
I'm absolutely sure something's going to slither out of it.
So, Petrus, as you're walking up, I'm going to get you to make a observation roll, D1, please. Okay. Hopefully the sand is out of your eyes at this point.
So, I'm observant, so I can roll another D20.
There you go. Okay. Good for you. So you walk up and you don't notice anything in particular, but you throw your torch in. And when you throw your torch in, on the sides of the, it seems to be like a longer hallway, and it goes off a fair distance. And you don't see anything on the other side, but it is a domed hallway, roughly 5 to 6 feet in diameter. But the whole entire sides of the wall are covered with more relief. Basses?
Yeah, bass relief.
Bass relief, sorry, yes. So, and what it is, you see a bunch of people, shapes of people, crawling. And they're all crawling in a line. And above the line of these people crawling on their hands and knees, you see shapes of the serpent. And the, you know, and above that serpent, you see various symbols of Set, you know, with the two snake heads facing each other. But they seem to be leading, going in one way. And there is like some sort of ancient Sanskrit writing reliefed on the inside of the archway.
Hey, I have lore. Can I read the writing?
It's,
yeah, and I do too.
Okay, this is particularly old and is really rough. So I'm going to say this is a D3.
Can I spend momentum to have an extra dice?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You can spend up to 3. That's what you're allowed to spend.
Okay, so I say plus 1.
I spent one of my momentum, and is this when I have to add the dice or I put a plus 1 in the modifier?
It's where you got to add it to the modifier.
And my lore is 10. Yes.
Wow, look at that. So, Maeve, you only rolled 2 dice, right? Oh, yeah, sorry.
No, I rolled 3.
But Amala, you rolled 3. So you need to spend the momentum too, right?
And I did spend no momentum.
Oh, okay. You never clicked on it, did you?
Yeah.
I thought, yeah.
Oh,
I thought right about my name.
Oh, I don't see it for some reason. That's odd. Okay, well, that's fine.
I'm not seeing Maeve. I'm only seeing mine.
Oh, Maeve.
Together, party.
Gosh, I got sand in my eyes, too. Maeve, can you double-click on your momentum? In the big square box? That's the one you got to click.
Oh, I know why I got 3 successes, even though there's 1's a 16. Because I've got the ranks in it, and I rolled a one, so that right. counts as two successes, right?
Yep.
Okay. So I got it.
Yeah, you got... I said it was a D2. Or
you said it was a D3. That's why we spent...
That's right. So you both got it. I got to spend the momentum there for Maeve. Okay. So right there, as you're kind of reading through it, you know, through the back, you know, your learnings and teachings, these symbols to you, although you can't really read it word for word, it represents that in order to enter, you must lower yourself in the way of the serpent in a sign of respect.
If they mean they go slithering on my belly, ain't happening.
Oh.
I'm going back out looking for more rocks.
But there could be great treasure within.
Yeah. What about Limbo? Is Limbo respectful?
Yeah, we can all Limbo in.
That would require a D4 acrobatics tech.
As in, how low can you go?
How low can you go? But that's what the Sanskrit says, isn't pretty much the gist of it, is that to enter the temple, one must lower themselves to be worthy.
Be worthy of a snake?
Well, technically a snake deity, but...
Ooh. Ain't my deity.
Well, mine neither, but... But what if there is a great treasure within?
So, can I have a little... Oh, never mind.
So I'm not really in the habit of going around and robbing deities anyway, anybody's deity. I'm particularly adverse to robbing snake deities because I'm not...
Even if it's evil, I mean...
Do we know enough about this type of god to know that this is an evil deity?
Well, like in all... pretty much all religions back in Hyboria... they all have some aspect, other than Mitra, which is the god of, justice and religion. All the other ones tend to have some sort of sacrificial or what others would seem as evil practices. You know of a god of Yog, which is actually the god of cannibalism. You know of the god of Set, which is of magic and sacrifice. So
yeah, see, and when I'm seeing those things crawling in there on their hands and knees, it kind of looks like they're crawling off to be sacrificed. That was my first thought.
Yeah, maybe that pet is still down there.
For more rocks.
But what if, by the design of this archway, it sets you to come in low? In a respectful position, as you guys have pointed out in the language.
I'll tell you
and
what.
To remain that way, in case there is, like if you were to walk, there would probably, I would guess, that there might be a trap or something along those lines. So you'd want to stay low.
Oh, yeah. Yes, exactly. No, I see.
How far into this tunnel can we see?
Yeah.
Well, the torch is probably thrown in maybe 20 feet. And you can see that probably another 20 feet past that, but it goes into darkness, so you're not exactly sure.
So Petrus, if you want to crawl in there and test it out,
I was going to say, we
can stand here at this end of the tunnel and watch and make sure nothing bad happens.
Is there a detect trap seal in this game?
Yes, and that would be, where's the two? Your thievery and or observant. Or sorry, thievery and or observation.
Okay, my observation is actually one higher. So, Petrus, what's your observation?
I'm very observant. I would like to do some observation.
Are you really?
I strongly recommend, Petrus, that you go crawling in there about 20 feet, retrieve your torch, do your observation firsthand. We'll stand here with our bows drawn in case something jumps out at you, and we'll make sure nothing happens to you.
Yeah.
Very well. To the victor goes the spoils.
You first. We got your back.
Yeah, I'd like to crawl in there a little bit and see what I can see.
All right. And I'm going to stand here while he does that with my bow drawn ready.
Okay.
I also will draw in.
Oh, you're going to crawl in behind behind Petrus? Maeve, you're going to crawl in behind Petrus, are you?
No, she's going to stand there behind him, though, with her bow drawn.
Okay, all right. So, Petrus, did you want to crawl in as far as your torch?
We no, not that cover. Far. I just want to go in and just on the other side and start my observation.
Okay. So you crawl in. I'm going to make you make another observation roll, D1. Oh, give yourself a moment. No, you only get one. Oh. You only got one. You only get two. No, one.
I'm very observant.
Yes, roll so another.
Roll another again. One and accept it.
That's right.
That's okay. Oh. What kind of lag?
Yeah, a little bit of lag, yep.
Oh.
But finally, you notice the sand that was in your eyes from earlier is finally starting to clear itself out.
Oh, thank goodness.
And you notice that the smoke that is being generated from the torch is actually drifting further inwards, as if there's a draft, something that you never quite really noticed beforehand. But there's obviously the smoke is not just filling up the tunnel, but is actually leading further in. As you get on your hands and knees, you can feel underneath, the grit and the sand is on your hands and knees, but you notice that the floor is very smooth and possibly even polished, it looks like.
Wow.
Yep.
Smooth, polished floor. A little bit of draft pulling the smoke out towards the fall end of the hallway.
That's the far end, yep.
And the chamber, did you say it was like maybe 16 feet or something like that, rounded top?
The chamber that you're in is roughly 20 feet. Or sorry, 20 feet. No, 40 feet is what I said. The chamber feet. That you're currently in, yeah.
With a, like, arch top?
With an arch, yeah, with a dome top, yep.
Dome top. I'm going to stay very low and crawl a little bit further towards my torch. And I am going to try to observe as I do that to see if there's anything.
Okay. So as you're crawling in, you're getting fairly close to your torch now. Make another observation roll. D1. Did you want to re-roll?
Yeah, I'll re-roll the 10, just see what happens. Yeah.
Okay. As you're getting fairly close to the torch, you actually catch a sparkle coming from the bas-reliefs that are in the wall. And you notice that it seems like every carvings of the people that are crawling in, there's like a sparkling in the where the eyes would be, and although it's relatively small, probably about the sparkle is about the size of your fingernail, your baby fingernail, it has a red glint. And if as you look, you realize that it's a ruby, and you see where you're currently lined up to.
Four rubies.
Four rubies.
Be careful about taking them, though, because it might be linked to something.
Well, I would have to.
He's got that curious thing going for him, though.
I am super curious, but I would have to get into a disrespectful position. I'm assuming since they're up on the wall. I'm going to stay in my respectful. I'm going to note the rubies to myself, and I am going to continue crawling towards my torch.
Okay.
And being observant as I go. So I'm going to go slowly. I'm going to slowly crawl towards my torch and observe as I do.
Okay, so as you get to the point of where the torch is, you can see now where your current location is, that you're kind of roughly halfway through the tunnel, because just up ahead, you can see now the shape of what looks like to be an exit way. And it's just a long, straight path that you're currently in right now. But it does seem to be another opening, roughly another 20 meters in front of you.
All right, so as I've come in, how wide is this hallway?
I says about 5 to 6 feet.
5 to 6 feet. So on my way in, I didn't observe any other entrances, any other unusual architecture.
Nope.
Other than the bas relief, the domed top, the smooth polished floor. I'm at the torch. I would like to take my torch and throw it towards the other end of the hall.
Okay, and as you do, I'm going to get you just to roll a D1 throwing check, which is ranged. So D1 ranged.
One ranged.
Yep.
Check that out. Okay. Oh, yeah.
Okay, so as you throw it out, now, Dan, this is something that I never introduced. This is a rule that I never introduced previously. Right now, you have a range of 9, and you don't have any ranks in it. So, you know, it's 9-0, right? If you roll a skill that you don't have any ranks in, a 19 or a 20 generates doom. Because you're technically not skilled in it. So, it is more chances of you generating doom for me. Mm-hmm. Just to let you know. So I'll take that doom, but your torch goes farther enough down the hall, down the small archway or the hallway that you're in, and you can see that it actually enters in through the doorway, and it lights up what appears to be, from where you are, a larger chamber.
All right. So at this point, I'm going to crawl back to the entrance that I came in.
Okay.
And confer my observations to Amala and Maeve.
All right.
I'm going to do that carefully, by the way.
You get back without any problem whatsoever.
Okay. And I'm going to recommend, when I'm conferring this information, that if we were to go into that other chamber, that we would probably want to crawl to it.
All right. That's no problem.
But why would we want to go to the other chamber if we can shelter here until the storm passes over? We need to find the rest of the caravan.
Oh, I'm with you on that. I've got a salt delivery to make.
If we can still make it.
The thing is that until the storm passes over, all we can do is shelter and... Unless he, found salt back there.
That would be the treasure now, wouldn't it?
Well, actually, some of those places where salt is worth your weight in gold.
And salt in this particular world, in this particular area, is relatively worthy. It is a you were working for a wealthy caravan dealer, right? Just so you know.
So I'm going to, if you guys aren't going to do anything else, I'm going to wrap up in my cloak and find a place, because I'm like exhausted. It's been a long day hiking through the wind, the storm, fighting that stupid camel. And I'll probably be asleep while you guys debate what you want to do.
Well, I'm going to stand guard for 8 hours or however long, and then sleep.
All right. And what's Petrus going to do?
I'll take it for a. I'll take a nap and I'll take the next watch, I guess.
Okay. So, You all kind of, the wind outside is still howling and the sand is still kind of drifting up in the main doorways, but you are getting relatively decent shelter. Although the noise, how loud everything is quite disturbing. I'm going to make everyone make a notice roll, just D1. Actually, hold on 1 second. Let me see here. I love Doom. Doom is awesome.
So is that reading that you currently have 6 Doom?
That's 6 Doom, yep. you guys are all getting... I'm going to spend 2 Doom. I got to spend 2 Doom to do something like this. So Doom... We're now down to 4 Doom. And as you guys are there and you're trying to make yourself comfortable and you realize, well, heck, you know, we're trying to get some rest and get some sleep. You look down and you notice that you're in your gear. Your gear is full with sand. You know, you guys have been covered in it. You know, your pockets are full of sand. It's, you know, relatively disgusting and gross and grimy and gritty. But to your horror, you notice that you're provisions, your traveling provisions that you had stocked onto your belts. The bag was... Oh no, I lost everyone. Everyone still there? Hello? Stand by, everyone. Temporarily lost connection here. Stand by. Lost connection.
I see he's online. Wow, he just popped back up online.
Well, while all this is getting sorted, I'm going to take a quick bio break. All
right.
Yeah, guys, anyone can hear me?
Yeah.
I think that we're on break for a little bit, or at least...
Yeah, I don't know what happened there. Everything just cut off. I saw everyone just leave the game. I'm like, okay, fine. I spent Doom. You didn't all have to get mad.
Oh, that's what you get.
The game forced us out.
And then I looked at Discord and I was disconnected from everything. But the only thing that didn't stop was my my stream and my internet. I still had internet access, so I don't know what happened there. So we're on a little bit of a break there, are we?
Yeah, I think it's just a little break.
All right. Well, I'm going to take this opportunity to refresh my rum beverage.
Oh, very good.
So I shall return shortly.
Those of you who got an invite, welcome to Nerd Prom.
No matter where in the world you are, we're all Nerds International. With the hyphen.
I thought thought my character was going to be a little tougher.
Now we're reconnected again.
Weird.
Shotgun's back online, JC.
Yeah, you'd be glad you didn't take Amala because she's armed in the kind of like brigade, Emily. Brigade is Emily's pirate merc. He was pretty deadly last night with those blades.
She's a two-handed fighter and she has a flintlock also.
That's cool.
So Jolly went to refresh his rum beverage. Hurricane punch by any chance? That's a nice rum beverage.
Wonder if he's got some screech.
If I had ice cream, I'd make me a brandy beverage, but I don't got any ice cream. It's too freaking cold here.
Oh, there's brandy goes with more besides ice cream. I mean, you can substitute it for whiskey and a lot of stuff.
There's two ways I like brandy. I like it in eggnog. I don't have any. I like it in vanilla ice cream shakes. I don't have any.
You can also drink it straight, but I wouldn't drink too much of it.
Not in a lot of years, honey.
Port and brandy is not bad, actually.
Metaxa. Metaxa is Greek brandy.
I've never had that.
Yeah, it's pretty potent brandy. Don't drink it straight.
Brandy actually goes pretty well with coffee, like if you have real strong coffee.
That's kind of self-defeating, mixing brandy and coffee. You get the caffeine, you get the...
Or you can just make strong.
You're all jacked up when you pass out.
Yeah, it's a pick-me-up.
You can just have strong kneecap.
All right, I'm back too.
I think we're on here.
Yeah, I think so.
All right. So before
Are you having a screech beverage?
No, it's a it's a Kraken.
Oh yeah, that's right.
I was
excited to that damn seaweed rum from Charybdis, is it?
It's not seaweed rum, nope.
Nasty stuff.
I don't have any screech on me at the moment. So yeah. So where was I got disconnected?
You were going to spend some doom to do something horrible to us. What?
Yeah, you just reconsidered spending your doom, I think.
Okay.
I think that was a sign from Set that if you spent that doom, it was going to come back on you badly.
So what happens is I spent two doom. I went down from six because I remember you asking how many I had. I had six, so I went down to two. So you guys, throughout the night, the wind is still howling and you all get some sleep. You know, you guys are covered in sand. It's from outside. It's still in your pockets. It's still in your hair. Very uncomfortable. But you guys all managed to get a fairly good night's sleep. So, Dan, you can recover any lost resolve that you have. You can bring your resolve back up to max.
What about me? I lost them.
Oh, yes, everyone. Yeah. Anyone who lost resolve can certainly bring back the resolve up to max. You had a good sleep.
I feel much more noble now.
Much more noble, yep.
I think we're just exhausted from dealing with losing the camp.
Well, obviously,
the storm died
right?
down yet.
The storm is still raging on. But to your horror and total like dismay, you realize that during the whole ordeal outside and jumping out of the sand pits, this is for everyone, that your provisions that you've had hooked onto your belts, your provisions, sand filled it up, ruining all the food and provisions that you currently had.
Oh.
and you realize that your water skins, that stuff, completely ruined. As now you got nothing but mud sludge. You got this a water skin full of mud, and your food is now gone. And the wind is still howling outside.
Wow.
Well, we could try and go find the camel.
Not through this wind. The camel's buried. The camel is dead. In the sand, it sucks sand, it's dead.
Yeah, but if it's buried in all that salt, it'll be well preserved.
I've got a feeling that the only option is going to be go deeper inside the structure to see if we can find what we need.
That, you know, that's so not true, because you certainly can go out and look for your camel and your cart if you wanted to.
Except for, you know, they're more than welcome to, but there's a massive sandstorm out there. So the odds are that all they'll do is end up like the camel.
Like, your options are completely, you're not limited to go. I want you to know I'm not railroading anyone. You guys want to go
and
inside,
have
you
guys
go.
Ever even heard of drum sands?
Drums? I have not heard of drum sands.
They're sands that they seem solid on the surface. The first, like, maybe foot is solid, but when you step on it, everything under it's dust. And when you step, it sets up the vibration, and it'll start drumming, and then it all collapses in. Sucks you in!
Oh, so that's something to kind of what I described earlier to you, that happened to you.
Yeah, except for the drumming, and drum sands are generally broad enough where
whole sections will go down, yeah.
If you don't jump back quick, you're going down.
Gotcha. Thank you. I'm putting that directly into my little tally book.
Yeah, I'm just a font of trivial information nobody needs to know.
Drum sands. All right. So you had a good night's sleep. You managed to recover your resolve. You know, get your get yourself back to somewhat regular operating efficiency. But unfortunately, you noticed that the sands and the windstorm managed to destroy your remaining provisions.
So we should all delete our provisions from our inventory?
Yes.
Bye, provisions. It was nice knowing you.
But nothing happened through you throughout the night. Now, the wind is still howling out there.
Are the torches still burning?
No, unless you guys wanted to say that you put them out as you slept. The one on the inside of the archway further in, that one's obviously burnt out.
Right, so it's cold and dark, and we might be eaten by a grue, and we have no food left.
Yeah, but we're going to have to, we can't go out. And I fear probably the entire caravan is lost unless they found shelter.
Yeah, we're going to have to go deeper in and look for provisions or something.
Water, at the very least. We can get by without food for a few days, even weeks, but water
maybe
is not
the snake,
optional.
Maybe the snakes worshippers have the equivalent of communion wine in here somewhere.
You never know.
More likely poisonous venom, but hey, let's not quibble.
Yeah.
It's liquid, right?
Can you wine wafers? Better than nothing.
Now, just to, as a little bit of GM advice here, just to let you know, you know, if don't let food be a big issue, because there's at least three of you.
Timothy.
I don't think there's
how
any
old
cannibals.
Are you, Jolly? Do you remember a song from, I'm thinking it's around 1971 or 72, it's called Timothy.
No,
yeah,
I don't.
Or, look it up sometime. It's on YouTube.
Well, everything's on YouTube now.
Yeah, I know. It's amazing.
When I think of what I just said reminds me. Was it Soylent Green?
No, because when he said Timothy, it was about three miners trapped in a mine. Well, there was three trapped, but only two came out.
Only two
Timothy.
Came out.
Yeah. Well, where on earth did he go? They can't remember.
Yeah.
They traumatized themselves.
He got lost in the dark somewhere.
Yeah.
But they came out well fed.
Yep, they were fine.
You all had a good night. The wind is still howling, still raging outside. Sand's obviously filling up a little bit more.
Water is an essential, so we're going to have to go slithering in there. You first, Petrus. It seems to be you. I'm wondering if it will be offensive if I have my blade in hand as I'm crawling.
I would put the blade on your belt so you can grab it if you
I can crawl with my blade in my hand. I can crawl with my blade in my teeth. Yes, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to crawl down there with my blade in my teeth like a pirate.
Fair enough.
Well, my bow will be strapped across my back, so.
Okay. So who's going first?
I'll go first. I'm young.
All right.
We had a vote. We had a vote. Petrus is going first.
I'm super I'll go curious. Second.
All right.
I don't mind going second.
So as you guys all crawl in on your hands and knees, keeping yourselves obviously, I would assume, low, just because of what you guys were previously saying. Petrus, you get to the center point, and you are at that same point where you saw those four rubies.
Thanks.
Or red stones. I'm going to say red stones.
Okay.
Could be garnets.
Could be rubies. Could be magical rubies.
Rhinestones.
Rhinestones, yep. Someone bedazzled the walkway.
Yeah, with our luck, we'd pry it out there, set off some monster, and find out it's cheap cubic zirconium.
Yep, or worse, glass.
Keep going. Move.
It's sugar candy.
You don't want me running over the top of you because I'm crawling, even if you guys pause to admire the pretty stones.
The pretty stones will probably set off a trap if we try and remove them or something.
You guys are so suspicious about stuff.
We've had some creative GMs.
Suspicious people live to be older.
All right, so you continue all crawling in the rest of the way, and Petrus, you get to the point now where you're pretty much at the entrance and you can see it's still kind of dark in there. Well, it is dark in there. You can't see that far ahead, but it seems to open up to a very wide area. Now, I never asked anything about torches, so am I going to assume that the two remaining torches were relit and you crawled in with them?
Sure, I will have taken mine.
All right.
I would let the ones in the lead take them, because I can just follow the light.
Okay. So, Petrus, as you come to the entrance, you can see the remaining stub of the torch laying on the ground in front of you. And in front of you, it lights up a large chamber. Now, this chamber, it has very high stone walls, roughly 20 feet, and more bas reliefs of similar symbols that you've seen the whole way in the first chamber and in the hallway are littered throughout the walls. On the opposite side of the room that you're in, you see what looks like to be a large wooden gated door, a large arch door, and it has the wood has been dried and it looks very, withered. There's big, large metal bands or iron bands that lead from the hinges inwards. And one of the doors seems to be slightly open towards you. And on the sides of the doors, you see two pillars embossed or, bas reliefs of two pillars on the side. And around these pillars, you see serpents. Coiling what looks like to be the column, and at the very top of the column, the two heads come in to meet each other again, facing each other above the archway door.
Wait, they're actually moving, or
no? It's just a bas relief. Everyone, make an observation roll. D1. Ooh, look at that! Petrus is able to see again. So it's everyone had a D1, so whoever rolled two or more gets their remaining momentum. And Petrus and Amala and Maeve, you all see a very bright, twinkling spark, you know, being reflecting from the torchlights in the tops of the heads of the snakes. It looks obviously like a large drems, and they look to be roughly the size of your fist. If you look at your fist, there are these large gems.
I wouldn't touch those. Probably bring the snakes to life.
Nothing is suspicious about this bunch.
Nothing at all.
Are we still crawling? I'm looking around for signs of baskets or urns or something that would contain water.
You're all kind of there by the archway now. You're kind of just standing up. I know, you know, Petrus is just inside of there, and you guys are there at the entranceway. Just to the far right-hand corner of the side that you walked in on, you see several large clay pots or urns, and they all appear to be sealed.
Mm. Well, those I would go and investigate. Because we're looking... We can't eat stones. We need water. We need food.
Okay.
I want to take a look at the bas relief and see if I can get some more clues. Like I got some clues from the hallway bas reliefs and see if it. I have a lore. Can I use my lore to see if I can, like, maybe find some indication that it would be okay for us to, you know, maybe remove those eyes and clean them for maintenance so we can put them back.
Go. It's gonna be a D2.
While I'm investigating, this is what he's doing while I'm investigating these clay pots, these clay urns.
There you go. So you managed to get your two successes. Because you're learned or something. What do you roll your extra lore?
I'm observant. I'm a noble. I don't work. I just watch.
Yes, but you rolled a lore. Lore and observation are different.
I'm sorry. That's right. You're right. I'm sorry.
Now, you kind of rolled that before I had a chance to tell you it was a D2. So did you want to spend a momentum?
I will spend a momentum.
All right. So you can just spend, you know, knock off a momentum. And you know, based on what you see, you remember reading in your studies. As a youth, by the, you know, the local sages of your father's house, that these symbols remind you of a story told of a lost city that contained wealth beyond unimaginable imagination. You just can't think of how much is there beyond imagination, how wealthy this place was. But it was lost, and you remember strictly it was lost to the sands of time was the scripture that brings it back to your mind, is what triggers it, you know. And the symbols talk about the, you know, this ancient city of serpents, or the city of serpents. But the wealth that it came from this place, the lore, this was a very rich and amazing city that got lost to the sands of time. It reminds you of that.
Hmm. Wow. I'm going to, if there's anyone listening to this young nobleman babble, I will inform anyone around.
Okay, so while you're sizing up that, and Amala is overlooking at the clay pots, and Amala, you realize right when you get there, these pots are sealed. They have like a heavy wax seal across the lid. They have lids. These pots come up roughly to your waist, and the widest part of the jar is roughly 2 to 3 feet wide. So they're fairly large pots, but they are all sealed, and in the seal of wax, what it appears to be, you can see, you know, symbols or structures that look very similar to the markings that have been you've seen already so far since you got into the structure.
Nothing that indicates to me that these might be water jars.
No, not from based on what you can see. But they all have handles. They all got the two big ear, or they all got the eared handles that come out from the side.
And how tall are they?
They come up to your waist. So let's just say roughly 2.5 feet.
Well, since the water situation is crucial, and I don't see any indication of anything else that might be a water source.
Not in this room, no.
I'm going to probably do something really stupid here now and start scraping the wax seal off.
Okay. You scrape the wax seal off. You scrape it all off to the point where you feel that if you want to lift the lid, you could.
And then I'm going to do the next really stupid thing and lift the lid.
All right. As you lift it, you hear like a type of sucking noise. You know, that air seems to kind of fill the space. And you see a slight puff of like dust kind of like come up from underneath the lid. And that's it. That's all you see. I'm assuming you're going to look into it.
I'm going to ask one of the other ones to bring the torch over so I can hold the torch over before I look into it.
I'll okay. Come bring a torch over.
All right. So as you come over and you hold the torch over the top and you guys look down, you can see inside of it what looks to be bones or small spinal-style bones, like a spinal column, but they're all kind of piled up on, like coiled up on one of another. And I'm going to get you guys to make a, let's see, make a survival roll or a lore, whichever you think is best. So yeah, D1, yeah, that's fine, that's good. So Maeve, you get a momentum. Amala, you get it. And Petrus, you get 2. And you guys realize that this jar is filled with what old skeletons of now ancient dead snakes.
But, yeah, right. I'm just going to put this lid back on.
Yeah, let's let the lid rest in peace. Orpy says.
I think we've disturbed somebody's, you know, funerary urns. Uh-oh.
Well, this won't take anything out of them because that would probably really.
Oh, I'm not going to. Once I see what's in it, I'm looking for water. If it's not water, it's useless. And so I'm going to put the lid back in. Although I probably can, you know, what wax I can squish back in there that I didn't totally destroy.
Oh, okay. You put it back so much. Yeah, so that's what you guys see. You see these, and as you look around now, you notice that these jars, and there are 3 of these jars in every corner, and all of them have similar markings.
Well, then I'm not going to investigate each one. We see a door over there. I'm still searching for water.
Okay, are you guys all going to go through the door?
Well, if it's partly open, we're going to go ahead and peek through it first.
Yeah, peek through it. Is there a can we detect traps?
Thievery. Let me see. How am I going to do that? Because this is kind of new for me with having thievery here. So just give me 1 second. I'm going to confirm how the best to do that.
I have a question. The symbols on the jars... When you say they're similar, do you mean that they're similar in that they all look the same? Or do you mean they're similar in that they're of the same writing, but maybe a little bit different?
Well, yeah, they have similar characteristics. You see familiar shapes, and they're not the exact same. But based on the snake theme and the style of the carvings, it all looks like it's done to represent one particular...
I was going to say, they all look like snakes...
They look like the one we opened looked like a funerary urn. If that's the case, and this was some snake city, then disturbing their mausoleum or funeral place is probably not a brilliant idea.
Probably no, it would invite bad luck at best.
Well, I'm not really fond of snakes anyway.
Probably the best thing we could do is to take those eyes, those giant eyeballs out of that snake so he wouldn't have to look upon his dead brethren.
Well, I'm going to peek in through the door. You can't. I'm going to look at this noble again and go, right now, we're in the middle of a raging sandstorm. We have no food and we have no water. And the water is going to become really urgent. Now, if you think you can drink those gems, have at it. I'm going to go peek through the door.
I'm going to just stay here just in case something jumps out at us.
Okay. So, first of all, I'll ask Petrus. Petrus, what are you going to do at this moment?
I'm going to stay with the party.
Okay. Now, I will say this to you, just so you know, based on what you've been looking at, it is climbable to get up to where those are.
I'll make a note of that okay. in case we come back this way.
And I'm not, other than making that, I'm not paying attention to him. It's not like I'm keeping an eye on him and making sure he doesn't do anything stupid. I'm peeking through the door.
I've noted where all the good stuff is, so if we come on this way on the way out.
Door number one. Come on, door number one.
I'm just looking at the rule for traps for now. Okay. Thievery is used for picking locks or disarming traps, sleight of hand, identifying strengths and weaknesses in security measures, and understanding crime. Okay. And observation is used for finding hidden things, noticing things.
Okay, so I should roll observation then?
Observation, yep.
So both of us were at the door and you needed observation.
Yep. So D1. Okay, so Maeve, you got yourself two successes. So that's two momentum.
How many momentum have you accumulated so far?
Well, I spent one, but I think I got six right now.
Oh, that's good.
Jeez.
So,
the force is with me this game.
You guys, you look around and you look fairly well, and you know you look hard, and you don't see any traps at all. This looks like at some point was an entranceway into like a temple, or you know, it doesn't look like there's anything of harm around. You don't see anything that looks like a trap at all.
Well, with the torches, okay. I'm going to push my way through the door, and I'll go ahead and take the lead.
As you open up the door with the torch, you immediately notice that there are beams of light or shafts of light coming from high up from where the ceiling would be. And you can see through these beams of light, you can see drifting sand drifting in and out, a little puffs of sand. And the area that you're in, over time, the floor is covered up with sand. But coming out of the sand, now this room is roughly, I'm going to say it's, let's see here, let's say it's roughly 100 square feet. And the floor is covered with sand, and the light is coming down in these beams, and the sand is slowly filling this place up over the years and over time. But coming out of the sand, going up towards the ceiling, you see on each, opposite of each other, you see two rows of eight columns, and the light is flicking off of these things, and they're glistening like a bronze or a brass, maybe even gold. And around each of these columns, you see more bas reliefs of serpents snaking up the columns up towards. And if you were to walk between the two columns of these two rows of columns, if you were to look up, these snakes, are facing each other, and in each of these snakes they have the similar glittery eye. And around in this square chamber with these eight columns, you see large gated exit ways that lead directly, north, east, and south. And you can see various boxes. You can see what looks like, buried in the sand, what looks like to be like an old cart, probably from there before. You can see tattered banners, tattered cloth. And yeah, like it's obviously like some sort of entrance way, some sort of like greeting place. Like this is like a major opening here.
So we see carts, and you said battered boxes, wooden boxes.
Wooden boxes. And now and some of them are drifted in with sand. And in some spots, the sand is probably as high as 10 feet.
Well, you know, I'm going to try to approach them because, again, I'm still looking for water or food supplies and poke at some of them with one of my swords.
Okay. What's everyone else going to do? Hello.
Hello.
Yep. So what's everyone else going to do? You know, I lose people again?
No. I'm still here.
Okay. All right. So what are you going to do, Maeve?
Maeve is looking into the tunnel, you know, with her bow ready and holding the torch in her other hand, I guess.
Okay. Petrus, what are you going to do?
Yeah, I'm going to observe as well.
Okay. So you guys are all in there looking around, and, you know, Maeve starts walking on in, and,
Maeve or Amala, because I'm going to investigate some of those
Amala.
Boxes.
Damn it. All right. So you go in to investigate the boxes. So you go over and have a look, and right off the bat, based on, you know, you're with the torch, these boxes are ancient. You can tell that the wind or the wood is like been petrified roughly or totally desiccated from the dry and arid conditions, and it's fairly brittle. You break it open, or, you know, if you go to touch it, you'll realize that it'll just shatter. It'll just break. Make an observation roll. Okay, no problem. Maeve, you're in there looking around. Oh, I'll take the doom.
Oh, no you won't, because I'm super observant. I'm going to re-roll it.
Very well. as the rest of, you know, you're overlooking at the boxes, you don't see anything of use. But both Petrus and Maeve, you notice a glint of looks like a glint of a greenish tint or a greenish thread or a flicker coming from one of the piles of sand, and you know it's kind of glistening out. You can just kind of make out like it looks like a line, very fine, but it's kind of glistening in the flickering light from the sunbeams in your torch. People
are noticing that I haven't found water yet.
Yeah.
Thirsty, the sand makes.
I'm going to shout a warning that I see something in the sand. It may be a trap.
Okay. What about you, Maeve? Is there a lag? Like, it seems like everything just goes dead, and I can't tell if you guys are actually talking or not.
I'm not hearing her talk either, and she's on Comcast. She could have lagged.
I don't hear her either. But that checks out.
But we can carry on until she gets back.
So he yells a potential trap. Do I look around and spot it now, or
you look around and you see where he's pointing, and you can see like a greenish tint of a flicker. In the sand dune, not that far from you, probably closer to the entrance that you guys just came through, but in the far left-hand corner.
I'll just take a couple of steps back away from it and keep an eye on it.
It doesn't seem to be moving. It's just flickering. It's like it's catching your attention. It's almost like a similar type of flicker that you see from jewels when light strikes a jewel or whatever, right?
Well, if I don't see it move or do anything weird for a minute, I still get my sword and I'll just go poke around in the sand by it to see what's causing the flicker.
Okay, what's Petrus doing?
Yeah, I'll investigate a little closer as well.
Okay, as you get a little bit closer, you can see, as you get closer, you see what looks like to be some sort of cloth or some sort of rag. And around the edge of it, you see what looks like to be an emerald style stitching that seems to be glinting. And it's only like a small corner. The piece that you see, or what you can see, only looks to be like roughly a size of your hand. But everything else is still kind of buried in the sand, right? But this is just what looks to be a piece of cloth with a stitching. Gold.
Well, I'm using my sword to scrape some of the sand away to see if I'm not touching it until I know what the hell it is.
As you okay, and Petrus, are you just going to sit there while that happens?
Yes.
Okay. So as Amala uses her sword to scrape away the sand, it reveals a larger patch of cloth, and you realize after just quick scraping, the cloth is actually part of a robe, and inside, underneath the robe, you actually find the bleached white leg bone and a foot buried in the sand. And it seems to be like some sort of very high robe, and with this emerald style stitching. It's a foot, a leg.
Okay, then I'm going to go ahead and get a hold of the robe and see if I can pull it free of the sand.
Make a strength roll as a D1. So when I say strength, that's there's an actual strength skill. Yep, that's right.
Try and find which column it's in.
Yeah. It's in your second top middle column. Acrobatics, melee, strength.
I've got acrobatics, stealth. Melee, stealth.
Oh, man, I'm blind today. Holy smokes.
Well, welcome to my world.
It's athletics then, sorry. Top right hand column. You managed to pull it out, and I managed to get some doom.
Good, he's taking doom.
You managed to pull out, and as you pull out the robe kind of, tears a bit and rips, but you managed to pull out a desiccated skeletal figure that's in a, what could have been maybe a red robe, but it's been so old and faded with time, it's hard to see. But the one thing that hasn't changed is the threading. And the threading seems to be like some sort of metallic weave. And you also see a golden weave, maybe brass, bronze, who knows. But that's also threaded and stitched into it, like an inlay. And on the robes itself, you see, stitched into the robe is more symbols of snakes, and again more symbols of snakes facing each other. As you hollow it out, the skull kind of breaks free and kind of rolls to the side, and you look at it, and the head rolls in such a way, the skull rolls in such a way that it props up on the ground, its jaw opening up in such a like a weird like it's almost like moaning, that look of it, like it's yelling, and you can see dark pits of holes in the skull, and it's looking directly at you, very foreboding and scary itself. But you pull it out, and that's what you find.
But the metallic threads themselves would be of value.
Yeah, very well. Easily could be.
So I'm going to shake the cloak out and kind of roll it up and start looking around to see if there's anything that looks like water.
as you...
Hey, dust is killing my throat.
as we as you wipe out the you know, start to kind of clear out the robe and stuff, you know, obviously the material, the cloth is like breaking in your hand and it's being tore out, but you know, several large strands of the weave is there. And the one thing about the green emerald looking weave is it kind of has that, the best way to describe it in today's world would be kind of like that fiber optic type of look, but it's very fine and it breaks in such ways that it's like in glass. So it's obviously very finely. You know what I'm trying to say? You know how I'm trying to describe it?
Yes. Fragile. Right.
Very fragile. But it's, you know, very, you know, it looks valuable and it looks like it's worth something.
Well, I'll do my best to, you know, now once I realize how quickly it's starting to break apart, I'm maybe a little more gentle with it and fold it up. And
yep. Everyone make a notice roll. D1.
Be observation.
Observation, yep. Oh, I like that. Look at the doom.
Two of them.
Look at the doom. Excellent. Oh, yeah, he re-rolls it. He re-rolls it. I still got one. And as you're looking at that, you all hear the sound of, like, a sudden shift in the distance. And it's kind of in the dark, but you certainly, you hear, like, a motion where kind of sounds, if someone took sand and pushed it, and it kind of slides down, like, a bit of, like, the ground is kind of given away in a certain spot, somewhere in the dark, not that far to the other side of the chamber. And everyone make a resolve roll. A discipline roll. A D2.
Okay, where is this one on the thing?
Oh, you're back. Did you get disconnected there?
No, I'm here.
Okay, because we were trying to get your attention there, and it's like you were gone. We thought you got dropped or something.
No, sorry. Okay.
No problem. Right. So you've let's see who passed. I said D2, so Maeve, you didn't do it.
I'm failing.
No, she failed because she
Amala failed too, and so did Petrus. If we only D2, nobody got.
We could any it, I suppose, theoretically.
No, not after the fact.
No, not
thing.
After.
Okay.
And all of a sudden, you guys hear a large bang and a large creak, as if one of the door on the far side of you that you entered in, the opposite door of the door that you entered in, suddenly creaks and swings, and such a large squeal of a noise that it absolutely stuns and shocks you. Roll 3d6 for your resolve. So you gotta, yeah, 3d6 against your resolve. So Amala, you take 2 points of resolve damage, and you're also stunned. Maeve, you take 3 points of resolve damage.
Where do you put stunned in there?
You can just type it in, or just...
Just remember it.
Yeah, just remember. It's more so for combat, right, that you need to worry about. So Maeve, you take... Now, if you have courage, whatever your courage soak is, it ignores that much. So if you have
she
courage...
She apparently is very cowardly.
Oh. And what about old Petrus?
Yes?
Oh, did you already roll it? No, roll your... Yeah, roll 3d6, please. So far, you've all been stunned. Amala and Maeve.
Sorry about that.
That's no problem. And Petrus takes 2 points of resolve damage and is also stunned. And as you look up and the door swings open, you see a shadow emerge, and it kind of wobbles back and forth and staggers from one side to the next.
It doesn't look like a camel, does it?
It doesn't look like a camel. And in the is roughly humanoid shape, and it, where the head would be, you see in the shadow what looks to be like a slight glowing eyes.
And oh, goody.
And at this point, I will say this is 2 hours, and I'll cut it off right here.
Just in time to get killed by the snake god. Or because a snake god priest that had, like, uber high power.
Those cliffhanger endings, you know. Everybody's got to be back next week now to see what the hell.
I got to see what happens.
Yep.
So, yeah, I hope you guys had fun. No combat. I just wanted to get the role-playing aspect in there and get the feeling of being trapped in a blizzard of sand.
Yeah, sandstorm sucks.
I've seen actual blizzards.
And they gave Emily a chance to see the 2D20 system. What do you think of the...
It's actually interesting and actually kind of easy to learn.
It's remarkably easy to learn.
We had a blast the first time with it. I like this system.
Yep.
And over the next week, Emily will take a look at the character generator. Although right now we're in the middle of this. Hey, maybe we can have some shaman come in and save our butts.
I just thought it was funny that I rolled a pirate.
You're getting really into the whole pirate thingy.
I know. Maybe I gotta get some rum this week for
yes.
Thursday.
If you can find Screech, Newfoundland Screech rum, if that's available.
I don't know if they have it in Minnesota. We just have like freaking Captain Morgan here.
But have a look, ask around, and if you can get it, you'll like it.
Okay.
Yeah. But yeah, so that's the end of Adventure 1 of the City of Dry Bones, and I hope that you enjoyed it and had fun.
Yep.
And yeah. That's...
So you're going to post in advance each week then, John?
I will, yep. And what I will do is I got
the... Nerd Prom.
I have the...
No matter where in the world you are,
the template for the character sheets made up, so I can email those to all of you. And that way
with the hyphen.
You can plug it into your own fantasy grounds and make your character and just email it to me, and then I can have your character ready to go when there's an opportunity to use it or if you want to use it, so...
I like these cat. Well, these pre-gems were all pretty cool, but then once you get used to the system, yeah, there's none of us are healers, right? Although that didn't save that poor kid. Didn't save that poor kid in the other game.
Well, at least you didn't kill off a healer yet.
No, in Adam's healers, we don't kill him off. He goes. Our healer goes running into melee. It's like he's trying to get himself killed. If you get yourself